Evening, ladies and gentlemen. How are you all doing tonight? Hope you're doing wonderfully. Now, before we start, I have a question for you guys. Did any of you notice anything different in the intro today? See if we can guess. See if we can who spotted it. Music name? Yeah. The title and performer. Actually, it's also a, but it's correct that I put the title and performer in, but exactly, Bad Batch, you got it. It's a slightly different composition. It is a slightly different version of Clair de Lune than I've used before. Now, if you've been following the channel for a while, you will know that I've in the past I've had some issues with, even though I have done. I've taken all the legal steps I need to do, and I have all the rights I need to use the old version of Clair de Lune I used. I would constantly get into issues with YouTube's Content ID system. And every time it happens, I have to swap out the intro for some other song. Huge pain. Now, luckily, last week, a guy called, I'm gonna try to pronounce his name correctly here, Shavin Passard, I think his name is, who's a pianist. He reached out to me and said, "Hey, watch your videos. By the way, if you're watching, hello." And he said he really enjoyed the intro and he thinks that Clair de Lune to some cinematic space video is an absolutely beautiful combination. And he recorded a version of Clair de Lune. And said that if I wanted to use it, I would be more than welcome to. And his version, I think, is different enough than the other version. And because his version is actually already on YouTube, that means that I should not be getting into any issues. So he has just probably just saved me a whole lot of hassle. And hopefully, fingers crossed, this means that YouTube's Content ID system is not going to get confused anymore. Because this is now should now have been fixed, like hopefully for good this time. So I just warned you guys. I'm gonna post his YouTube channel. He does. He's a composer. Like a, he's a pianist, I think. So he does recordings of him playing piano, and he is super good. If you like that intro, if you like his piano playing there at the beginning, then go do me a huge favor. I'm gonna post his YouTube channel. Go over there and check out if you like to have some like calm piano music to listen to. Find his Clair de Lune video. Go down and say hello to him from me and go over. Yeah, check it out because huge thumbs up. That was absolutely awesome. That's also why you can also find the link in the I'll put down in the bottom of the description together with all the other links. So you can find that there as well. Metal is the only music that matters. So, kind of, I do. I mean, when I'm not, if I'm sitting, like just today, I found the longest playlist I could of AC/DC songs on YouTube, put that on, and then just sat there writing code all day. It was a good day today. I do love my heavy metal. I used to have hair down to like lower back kind of length hair. like 6 7 years ago. We haven't gone to light gold yet. We'll get to that in a second. So yeah, I've yeah, I was a metalhead most of my I want to say most of my youth, but that's what makes me sound so old. Pictured or it never happened. Okay. Hold on. I'll see if I can dig up an old picture somewhere. There should be something. Hold on, give me a second here. that should be doable, shouldn't it? Let's see. Pictures, old pictures. We have to go way back. Oh, there we go. There you go. That's Astro high school years with a Flocking Molly t-shirt and long curly hair. That's a few years ago now, isn't it? So yeah, I've spent more nights than I care to admit on back then the only metal nightclubs that existed. There were two at some point, but most of the time through most of the high school, there was pretty much just one in my area. And when I say my area, it was 40 kilometers away. So that means every Friday, me and my friends would meet up at the local train station. And we will take the train into Copenhagen, lived outside Copenhagen back then. And then we'll spend the night on that like heavy metal rock nightclub. And then take the first train home in the morning when the trains began going again. Sometimes it got a little later than the first train, but yeah. Anyway, let's get back to the spaceships. Space travel really changed you. Yeah. Space travel has a tendency to do that, but let's talk about what we're going to do today, and then we're going to set a light goal, and then we're going to get going, and we have a decision. Yes, we're going to go do that in a second, Dongle, and then we have a decision we need to make. So first of all, plan for today is I mentioned it in the Hello Dave. Yeah, we're going to do an easy one today. I wanted to go out and do some Vista hunting. We just saw the intro. All those shots was made back with Horizon. And I want to go and begin the work of getting some new B-roll shots for the stream intro that also includes some Odysseys. There's still some of the old ones that's going to stay. But I want to go out and we can see if we can find some pretty shots. But let's see what we have in terms of light goals. We have somebody saying 250, 275. Dongle Lord suggesting 173. How many people are we right now? Let me see. Get that update. We're about 100 on YouTube. 50 is too easy. 50 you can't do. Let's go with a very easy one. And let's just say 150 today. We've got to be... Let's take an easy one. Okay. Sebastian puts forward a good argument here. He says it should be 100. And we got to change it now, Doug. He said it's going to be 111 because it's 1/6 of 666. Now that we just talked about being a metalhead. I think let's go 111 then. That should be fun. Okay. 111, that should be very, very easy to reach. So as always, if we reach 111, I will be setting up a discount code on the merch store as always, where you can go ahead and get yourself t-shirts and hoodies and mugs, all that cool stuff. For instance, by the way, mug today is the Down to Earth Australia mug, which you can get. There's also the Remember Your Olympics mug, North Star mugs, all that stuff. Okay, now, I said, I'm going to use that corner today. That we have a decision to make. So you might, if you've been following the news, and there has been some rumors floating around that... So there's been this mystery going on in Colonia. I must admit I haven't had the time to read up on the lore completely, but there's been some kind of mystery with it, but you've never been able to solve it because there was a broken data point in it. Maybe it wasn't broken, maybe it was intentionally broken, I don't know. But at least there has been hints that that data port should spring to life on the 26th. That is the day after tomorrow. And that is right around Colonia. So, I don't know if there's going to be anything happening, any major things happening. It could just be a small little law event. It could also be something big. I don't know. But what I need to decide now is, do I continue all the way out here, which is my original destination, or do I turn around and fly back down to Colonia, which is down here? You can see we haven't really made it that far. We're only 1800 light years. I personally, I'm more leaning towards, because again, we're only 1800 light years. We can get up here again very quickly if you want to, and we can neutron jump a bit of the way if we really want to speed things up. Yeah, I think too. Also, because if something interesting happens, it would be nice to have a character in the area so we can live stream the event if anything happens. So I think I'm actually gonna say that was probably the shortest exploration trip I've ever done, and begin to head back towards Colonia again. Stream title is wrong. Oh, did I forget to change the stream title on Twitch? Hold on, give me a second. I might have. Oh yeah, I have. Oops, my bad. Give me a second. That, and also the wrong game even. It says I'm streaming Star Citizen. Switched over to Elite Dangerous. And update that. There we go. Sorry about that. Okay. Yes, it was a short jump, but we got two volcanoes, and I got into a whole heap of trouble, and I only made an ancient model legends. Let's make it back. Now, we're going to use the same method as always. I'm going to take the slow route this time. So just plot fastest, no neutron stars, just straight up normal jumping, and we're going to see what we come across. I'm going to use the same method as always, where I'm going to be stopping only in systems where I know there are some interesting planets. We might speedrun it at the end. I'm going to make it in this live stream. I want to make it to Colonia in this live stream. If we don't, then I'm going to speedrun the last little section and just, yeah, beeline it for Colonia. But the main point, of course, is I want to see if we can find some pretty places where we can shoot some B-roll. And also, it kind of would be a nice follow-up to the video I did earlier, or late last week, Sunday, I think. Oh, I should probably fuel scoop. Let's go into scanner mode. There we go, honk the system. Honk. Okay, so again, I'm looking for stuff, in this area here between the A in spectral and the second A in analysis, because that area is where we have Earth-likes, water worlds, ammonia worlds, those kind of planets, which are highly valuable, which is the main thing I'm looking for right now. So we're just going to keep going. We have only 32 jumps. It's going to be piece of cake. Piece of cake. Of course, the problem is when I do fight a system, I always end up spending 2 hours there before I go anywhere. Thanks for all the guys following over on Twitch, by the way. A ton of you guys today. Yeah, sorry, Andy. There was some confusion with the. I forgot to update the stream. It should be updated to Elite now. But yeah, see you next time, which is hopefully next weekend. We're gonna be streaming since Star Citizen. Another very, very hot star, so doesn't bode well for Earth likes. Oh, I said that too early. There is actually a water world in this system. Okay, we're gonna scan that. See what we got. Gonna clear the star and oh right, yeah, it's there now. Maybe not. Okay, let's see what we got here. There's the star. Oh great, there's a B star. How far away are these? Does it say? Features. Oh, there's biologicals on this one though, so that if it's an no atmosphere though. But B2 has biologicals on it. But I do prefer it if we could have an atmosphere and if it's not too far away. Okay, that's the asteroid clusters. Let's get those out of the way. $60,000, bottom left, okay. Right, yeah, there it is. And then there should just be the water world left. Nice. Okay, let's... oh, look at that. B2 did have an atmosphere. It's very thin. Let's just check what we have here. So we have a candidate for terraforming. Another candidate for terraforming. The water world. And another candidate. So I want to start out here, I think. Let's get going. Just because they have a little bit of value to them. And so the plan is scan these. And if these two are close enough to each other in their orbit, then we could maybe get some cool shots of those two planets. But I don't think they're necessarily that close. But then I want to head out to B2, which was the one with biologicals on it, I believe. And because it's also an atmospheric planet, there could be some cool shots. Look at the atmosphere here. We can actually begin to see it. You can see how it turns red there at the edge when you go down. So that kind of gives an indication of what the atmosphere will look like. So let's see if we can't find some cool plants on this world and get some pretty shots. Now for the stream intro, I prefer to see if we can get video clips without people or ships in it. Yes, we are going to land on it. Because if I do it with ships, it will always be the same crate in all the shots, and I kind of like it to be just planets, or in this case, vistas. That's the plan. We're gonna have some cover to us, some cover to distance first. The distance to cover first. What are vistas? Vistas are pretty sights, things that looks nice. It can be from space, it can be from the surface. Rhino says screenshot taken. I assume he's probably watching the start of the stream right now. Am I using the SCA module for capturing your approaches? Supercruise assist. Ah, relax. SCA. I don't believe I actually have supercruise assist on this thing. Maybe I do? No, I don't. Yeah, exactly, Ryan. We're trying to make a new intro for this live stream. This is going to take some time. Some of the old shots are going to survive, like the shots of... I should actually do that at some point. I should head back down to the Planet of Death and get some new glorious 4K shots of that, because that is still... only, not that it really matters, I'm streaming at 1080p anyway, but I kind of want 4K shots of the Planet of Death at some point. unlike the Microsoft operating system, which Microsoft Vista sucked. Yeah, well. It also had a lot, Vista really had a lot to live up to after XP, didn't it? No, I'm not. I don't need intro music. I actually just got a new recording of Claire de Lune, which I'm going to use. Content about making content. Yeah, it was kind of. It was. I also thought it would be nice as a follow up. If you didn't watch it on Sunday, I published a video where I go over some tips and tricks on how to shoot video in Elite. I'm talking about the key bindings, but also some of the tricks I use to make the shots more interesting. Not necessarily looking like just quality wise, but also what do you do to make your shot more interesting? I can try to show you some of it as well here. And what are some of the tricks that I use to get more camera control when I'm shooting so you can do some of the more fancy flying. What tools am I using for video editing? So I use Elgato have a 4K capture utility. That's capturing 4K video from my capture card on the secondary PC. That's the one you're streaming. I'm streaming from right now. Then I use Audacity for capturing audio, and I use OBS for capturing webcam or the face cam. And then I use Sony Vegas Pro to edit it all together at the end. And you can see here all the specs in this chat now. Now, where did that other planet go? There was another planet a second ago. So that is behind us. Oh. Did I mess something up with my head tracking? Apparently I did. Okay, so it's somewhere up there. That is actually pretty cool with the dense star field. Hold on. It just slow us way down here. Let me just quickly go, and I'm gonna get the capture utility here. 60 GB of RAM. The 60 GB of RAM, I used to have 32, but I had to upgrade after I started making videos in 4K. I actually had to upgrade because the video files got so big that I couldn't effectively have, like, render them quickly enough. So my RAM was a bottleneck. I got RAM saturated. So, just gonna clean my recording folder here on the PC. There we go. Okay, I just wanna try to see if we can get a shot. There we are, now recording. I'm looking for like a slow shot of us moving next to the planet. So I'm gonna lock that to the ship. Gonna put the ship in motion. And then I'm gonna give myself a little bit of camera movement. It's not the right, it's a little brown, muted in the colors, but the stars look great. I'm just gonna slowly let the planet drift through the frame towards the center here. And then let it drift away. Nice. Stop that recording. I'm just gonna get this out of the way there. Have I tried Space Engine yet? Yes, I have. It's a little, it takes a while to get used to it, but it's one of those programs when you really do get used to get good at it, you can make some amazing shots. Okay, slow us down. We can do a quick survey of this planet. What is this? 6 probes. Oh, perfect hit. Surface scan complete. Moving on to planet 6. Hold on. Oh, now it picked it up. And it's just the head tracking. Is B-roll capturing basically Elite's endgame? I don't know if it's the endgame. Oh, this planet could have... Oh, I should have done it with this planet. This one is even better. That's, of course, the water world. If that has some nice clouds on it, that could look really cool. Yeah, I'm just going to start another recording here. Okay, I want to try to see if we can get a shot here of us, like, starting with the planet at a distance, and then coming in and see if we can make it fill up pretty much the full view. We're going to start the track here. It's not going to take up the full view. Okay, I'm just gonna try to go a little closer this time. I just wanted to finish that one and then see if we can go even closer to it. So we really get that, you know, feeling of the planet just take up our entire field of view. So let's go and reposition the camera. Stop the ship flying and take over control of the camera. Yeah, this is better, where you can really go in and we can begin to see the details and the clouds and the hurricanes and the surface. I don't want it to completely take up the screen. I want to keep a little bit of star in the background. There we go. Okay, let's scan this thing. Stop that recording. Stop it. I don't want to use up more disk space than I necessarily need for this. That's one downside of recording everything in 4K. It takes up a ton of disk space. I think I spent around 26 gigabytes or something per hour of recorded gameplay. How does that look? That should be fine. Welcome to r/data hoarder. I guess so, yeah. So as you can imagine, I do need quite a bit of of disk space. But that's also why I've decided to I built myself a NAS, so I have a little. I have a 12 terabyte NAS at the other end of the apartment that I use for storing everything. And so you see how much is on it right now? Terabytes of used space, 60% full. There you go. I record this 28 gigabytes an hour to a regular drive. And then I transfer it over to the NAS after that. So that was 6 weeks to find Planet 5. What kind of NAS? Free NAS. Full, okay, so the full capacity, so the array is built of, of six drive with 2 terabytes on each drive, but it's running with 2 redundant drives, meaning I get 8 terabytes of usable space. And I'm currently using 6.7. So, yeah. I have about 1.3 terabytes left. And then I'm out. And then I need to figure out then what. I would probably upgrade the drives in the array and then try to sell the old drives again. Yeah, so if I had to rebuild the array, I would probably do with just 1 redundant drive instead of 2. But I do want to have 1. No, so the redundant drives are not for fast load. The redundant drives are there for security. Because those drives are constantly on, constantly spinning, that means if I lose the drive, which has happened at least on 3 occasions, I've had a drive die in my NAS. And when a drive dies, because I have redundancy, I can always pull out the dead drive, replace it with a new one, start a resilvering process, wait a day or so, and then all the lost data will be rebuilt. Because I have, basically the drives are covering for each other, if that makes sense. So I can always rebuild. Even with 2 dead drives, I can rebuild the array without losing data. But if I lose a third drive, then it's gone. And then everything is gone, completely gone. And that's why I also keep backups of like important files, like my logo and templates for Hello Dave and templates for videos and thumbnail templates and all those like small files that doesn't take up much space. But are just super important, and if I lose them, it's gonna be a huge amount of work to rebuild. And those backups are, of course, off-site. So this stack, I don't have full off-site backup of every single video I've ever shot, but I have off-site backup of the important files. So if I were to lose those, I mean, then I have them in a cloud somewhere, and then I can always rebuild from there. Okay, that was that planet. Let's go to the one we're actually here for, which is that one. Hold on, I did stop the recording, didn't I? From before? Just checking. Yes, I did. Have I thought of switching to SSDs? Not really, because I don't need the extra speed. As it is right now, I can comfortably edit 4K video off the server. So when I'm editing, all the video, as soon as I'm done recording on my secondary rig, all the video files and audio files get transferred over to the server. And from the server, I'm editing live off the server from my main PC because it has a bit more horsepower for that 4K. Hold on, that's the system. Hold on. Stop that. But because I'm the only user of the array, there's no need for me to get the extra speed that I get out of solid-state drives. So therefore, it's much better for me to just buy some higher capacity, spinning disks, because the speed is fine as they are, as long as I'm a single user. And I need the capacity more than I need the speed. Yeah, exactly. And I'm running gigabit LAN in the whole apartment, so that means I have a gigabit connection out to the server where I'm editing from. But as far as I know, and if there's anyone who's ever done it, I would be very interested in talking to you. If any of you have ever tried to expand an existing FreeNAS array, I would very much like to hear your experience with it. As far as I can read on like forums and Google, people say what you do is you take out one drive, you put in a higher capacity drive in its place, and then you resilver it. And then you take out another drive and you replace that with a higher capacity drive and resilver that. That means this whole process, remember, resilvering of the array takes about a day-ish, like 16, 20 hours maybe. And that means if I have to replace 6 drives, it's going to take almost a week to expand the array like that. And it's going to be nerve-wracking. So hopefully that should work, but that also means I need to go out and if I'm gonna go out and expand to more drives, I'm not just gonna go and double the array. I mean, I would probably look into getting an array of, I don't know, go up from 2 terabyte drives to 10 terabyte drives or 8 terabyte drives or something, depending on price, basically, because I need to have proper NAS drives. I'm not gonna, when you build a NAS, I learned this the hard way, by the way, you don't just go out and buy the cheapest hard drive you can find. You buy drives that are specifically built for a NAS, that are specifically designed to be running 24/7. Buy another NAS, get more drives. Nah, no. I like the look of this planet. Never worked with FreeNAS. That a software solution? Yes, it's basically the OS that's running on. It's a branch of Debian that's called FreeNAS. That is a branch of Debian that is designed to run as a NAS. Is it hard to get your own NAS in terms of setting it up? No, not at all. Oh, hold on. So I got to check. What do we have here? What are you? You are bacterial colonies. I think those are just like surface. I think these are just are just like surface patches on the ground. But let's go down and check. So what I learned was we want to go for the green areas. That was what I was told last. So normally I would say the dark blue would be where you want to go, but there's this like big greenish areas. I'm going to try to go down there. And if not, then we're going to try these dark blue areas or the light blue areas. Yeah, exactly. I'm also using WD Red drives. 2 terabyte WD Reds. I also, one of the things I learned early on was you need to cool your drives. When you have drives packed that much together, they need cooling. I lost the first two drives I lost because I didn't have sufficient cooling around my drive compartment. And they just overheated and died. Oh, hello. Disable night vision. Not that much at there is definitely an atmosphere here. But this just looks like a desert. Oh, there is something there. Yeah, so that's... That is what we got here. It's those patches. Yeah, it's space not exactly. I'm just gonna go and scan it. Just because we can. This is my space not. I'm the first to discover this space not. Let's see if we can find a bit more of it. Oh, there's more here. I don't know if that's far enough away. Oh, this is all over the place here. Look at this. Let's put it down here. Maybe someplace where we can actually land. Space COVID. Oh, there's more of it here. This looks landable. Apparently, we're not far enough away yet. Oh, hold on, what's going on here? I got some screen tearing for some reason. Oh, now I can sample it. Okay. Let's go and find one more. Good morning to you guys over on Twitch. I want to get a shot from the surface here. I kind of like this deserty look. I'm just gonna go a little bit over here where it's not so rocket, and then see if we can't find more stuff out here in the open. Something here in the flat area maybe. That would be awfully nice. There's a spot there, I'll take that. Oh, if I can actually find a place to put this down. Ah! World's smallest landing spot. Scan it with my ship for the codex? Don't believe you can you? Oh, you can. Oh. There we go. Oh, we actually landed on top of it. Look at the canister, press the button. Don't know why, but we are. Look at the power drain. Lost 11% just from that. Power drain in this suit is real. Okay, I want to get a shot here. What I'm looking for is kind of like the... landing gear up, please. There we go. Good little ship. So I'm looking for like a shot where where we kind of like flying over the surface. I'm going to log it to the ship there. Turn the FPS counter off. I'm going to start the recording here. Now what I'm also looking for is I'm looking for something where it looks like we're moving a little slow, so I want to zoom in a little bit like this and then start the movement here. Then maybe speed up and then lift up for altitude. I don't know how well that went. Actually, maybe this wide shot is not so bad. Keep that thing flying. And then just do a pan upwards like this. Okay, people like the shot. Oh, I'm just experimenting a little bit now. There we go. And just getting as many shots in as possible. Should we just, for good measures, go to the day-night terminator and just check out what it looks like? Should have from the more altitude. Do we understand the heat map? Can you explain it? So the heat map... Hold on. There we go. So the heat map, when you look at it down there on the side, as I've been told, the green areas is what you're looking for, mostly. So you have the dark blue and you have the light blue, but mostly the greenish areas is where you want to go. At least that's as far as I've been told. There we have the Terminator. I think let's go down some of this more rocket area. There's nothing there in terms of like plants or anything. It's 12 kilometers up. Should have the sun come down even lower. Kilometers. So it gets a more yellowish tint. And the mountains, all those mountains look amazing. Let's try something similar again. We move the camera out here. We lock it. I mean, everybody loves a good sunset, don't they? So let's do like a fly into the sunset kind of shot here. Hold on, Ella. Okay, I'm locked to the ship now. Hold on. There we go. Messed up my camera positioning there. Just get that back in place, like there. You get this thing up to speed. Oh, I have an idea here. I want to try it out. We have enough of it just flying straight. I want to see if I can get the ship down far enough that we can go behind this mountain. And just get out of that, like, shaky shadow area. And then come flying down here. Follow the ground. Follow the ground up along the mountain for that, and then accelerate upwards. That was a good shot. That came out epic, I think. I really like that. Cool, nice. Okay, onwards to the next system. It got what we came for here. And we're gonna move on. Hey, we're at 111. I told you we could do this. It was easy, easy, not even an hour in. I told you it was too easy. So, first of all, huge thank you to all the guys who liked the live stream for helping us reach the 111. Now I need suggestions in chat. Are you guys already going? I need suggestions, chat. What should the discount code be for the merch store? So we're gonna set up the code now. Dongalore suggests Windows Vista for the win. We have Space COVID. Metalhead 42 Space. Someone second Space COVID. And it's just on Twitch. Not yet. We have two votes for Metalhead. Long hair astronomy. Oh, it's a tie. It's a tie, it seems, between Metalhead and Space COVID. Okay, I know what we're gonna do then. I know exactly what we're gonna do. Let's see here. Gonna log in. Discount codes. No, no. Not related products. Discount codes. Thank you. I'm gonna create a new one. Metal COVID. And I'm gonna go and do like this. This is gonna mess up all Dongalora scripts. There we go, like that. I'm not gonna spoil it yet. And there we go. I've now set up two discount codes. One of them is Space COVID, and the other one is Metalhead. That means you can now go COVID. Yeah, I think that's right. There you go. You can now go to d2astore.com and you can use either Metalhead or Space COVID. And if you do that, you get 10% off to get yourself t-shirts. If you want yourself a new fancy mug, you can do that. Again, today's mug for me is the normal down-to-earth astronomy mug. But there are many more designs, also some funny ones like the like the Don't Forget Your Limpets mark. Or the pre-flight checklist is also becoming very popular. Where there's a mark with like a little pre-flight checklist of all the stuff you need to remember before you take off in Elite, which is very handy. You should do a pint mark. Yeah, problem is, it's a long story, but the problem is I'm a little bit limited in what products I can do based on the supplier that I'm working with, because the store is not nearly big enough that it is practical for me to keep my own stock. So I have a third party that takes care of all the manufacturing, and that means I'm limited to the products that they can manufacture, and they don't do pint glasses yet. Hopefully someday. I should do like a mock that says, I swear this is water and not vodka of gin or something like that. Don't drink and fly, maybe. Or maybe do something, you know, like, I I'm just thinking of, like, you could do a mock something like, space is empty, but there's always a star in your way when you least expect it. Don't drink and fly. Something like that. Yeah, no EMP. I spent my fair share of money at EMP. What's up, noisy bunny? Oh, while we're jumping here. Let me get my bunny cam. Where's the bunny cam app? Oh, and I need to not fly into a star as well. That would be lovely. There we go. And then I just need to get the chat back again. There we go. Now I can swap over to Bunny Cam. There we go. So look at that. Bunny eating all the Toby cardboard. You remember if you saw the live stream? See? We're eating away at all the Toby cardboard. And they're still eating away at the Toby cardboard. What kind of rabbit? I don't know. How far away from Colonia? 28 jumps. That bunny, that's Preben. They eat the cardboard? Yes, they do. They eat the cardboard. Yeah, but the problem is the bunny cam is my phone, which I'm holding up manually. So it's not, like, can't keep it up at all times. Yeah, I have tried to use RTX Voice or NVIDIA Broadcast. I've just not had a good time with it. It's causing issues. It got some multi-mount ability here, maybe. Maybe find something. I try to, at least when I'm recording, I try to make sure they're not making too much noises, but doing live streams, I don't mind too much. Live streams are intended to be a little bit more rough around the edges, I think. But yeah, I don't know what it is, but the bunnies, for some reason, they like the cardboard. Might a GoPro on your bunny? I don't think. One of them, maybe. One of them, the black and white one, he usually don't mind too much having a leash on. The other one, she will go absolutely mental if you try to put her in a harness. Yeah, we are playing Odyssey, and I mean, stability-wise, I think Odyssey is okay where it is. I still, from time to time, have a random random crash to desktop. Still does happen, but it's definitely improved a lot. I also think a GoPro would be a little bit too heavy for a bunny. I mean, these things are just not that big. Not like a dog. Yeah, I mean, stability-wise, it's a lot better. And there's still some of the cockpits that might need a little bit of tweaking. Lighting-wise, this one is fine, but I think it's the third lens that still has some issues. And there are other, like, things I hope they're gonna add down the line. But, again, update 7 looks promising. What are the bunnies called? The bunnies are called Einar or Preben. Einar and Preben. And the weird thing is they have both like normal the normal food they get. They also have leftover salads from dinner, and they're still sitting there eating cardboard. Hold on, why is the light from this star so purple? That light, is it just me or does the light here look incorrect? I mean, look at the light down there. What type of star is this? Ah, it's a Titauri star. Because it looks like that star, I would expect to have that kind of light. Hold on, how close is that other star? If I can find it. Okay, that's far away. Light seconds. The other star is out there. Can you call a bunny? Like, do they recognize your name? No, they don't recognize names. But they do recognize if you whistle. They sometimes do recognize that. And I've taught them that if I sit on the floor, they will always come because then they know I have snacks for. But look at that. Lighting on this star is way off. This is weird. And nothing wrong about purple, but it's not the kind of star I would expect to send out purple light. Yeah, it's all rocky worlds. Now I'm kind of curious. I'm just going to go to the first planet. Which is hopefully relatively close. I just want to see, because it has an atmosphere, I just want to see the light from the star passing through the atmosphere, just to see what that looks like, if it's also very red. Do I think Odyssey is worth it? For me, absolutely. Both because of what it adds to exploration, which I still think is the absolute best selling point for Odyssey right now, is the fact that you can get some of these very, very pretty atmospheric shots. The stuff at the bubble is still a little limited in terms of content, but hopefully it's going to get better. I know they're tweaking conflict zones in the next update here. That star looks completely off. Look, it doesn't even have like any bloom or anything to it. You see? I mean, there's nothing from that star. I'll try to go and turn my bloom settings off. Fire all the way up. See, still nothing. Okay, I have to check this. I'm just gonna quickly jump out to main, not to main menu. I'm gonna quickly relaunch the game. I just wanna see if this star just loaded incorrectly or there's an actual mistake. Temperature of the star is probably very low, I would expect. The planet we were at is not landable. It has an atmosphere, but you can't land at it. It's a Titari star, but I think there's something wrong with the Titari stars. At least that one was. So for the people talking about whether Odyssey is worth it, yeah, but it still has stuff like this sometimes, where there's just something that just doesn't look right, and it's just a little bit off. It's small things. I also looked at it last week, where there was some weird things going on with surface temperatures when you were in systems with a neutron star. So there are some weird things going on. Sometimes. Nope. Rebooted the game, we're back in. Same deal. Ready to engage. 4, 3, 2, 1, engage. That is so weird. Let's try to go in close again. I haven't checked the other star. It's 30,000 light seconds away. I haven't flown out there yet. I'm just going to try to get out of this gravity well. What's going on with the screen sharing today? But look at that, there's no flares on it either. It's completely smooth. Gonna try to go in all the way to the exclusion zone. Oh, there's one there. Very faint, though. We found the night side of the star. Oh, right. Still in cooldown. Come on. See if we can get out of this without overheating. Four, three, two, one, engage. Warning, temperature critical. 80%. And it's going back down again. Yeah, Titaui are cool styles, but they just look... The lights just look a little weird. Okay. Is there a release date for update 7 yet? No. All we know so far is, I believe it's September. So, we just know September. I am about 24 jumps straight up from Colonia-ish. We should be like 1200 light years or something. See, that's more like it. Three jumps to go. I think that Nephilim can see the upper head. Can't see it now when we're in which space, but look at the next jump. I think we have the Colonial Nephilim upper head, the one we're gonna be heading to. I mean, about how many jumps per hour can I do in a live stream? I think it's easier to cover in light years. I usually, on an effective live stream where I'm not spending too much time on planets, if I just, you know, scan the interesting planets, take a few screenshots, a few video shots, and then move on, I can usually do like 2,000 light years in the live stream. But the last two ones, I haven't gotten far. Then I found something interesting, and then I got stuck in a hole. Okay, weird. So then last two live streams, we didn't really get that far because I ended up getting stuck. But usually I do like 2,000, so about 1,000 light years an hour, which is not super fast. But again, it's also I like a slower approach to exploration where I don't necessarily have to rush everywhere. For me, exploration is much more about the journey than actually where I'm going to go. For me, personally, I could just find... I just need to have something at the end that I'm flying towards. And then I don't really care how far it is. I'll just keep flying until I'm there. Yeah, exactly, Badger. Until I find a volcano, and then I get stuck, and then it takes an hour. I have the highlight of that ready, by the way. It's gonna come out this week. I think it's pretty epic. Fuel scooping complete. Frameshift drive charging. Hold on, where are we at right now? Likes wise. Where are we at? We're at 159 right now. No, that's concurrent viewers. Sorry. 132. Okay. I'll make you a deal. Let's put up a stretch goal today. If we make it to 150, I'll give you a little preview of the video that comes out later this week. It's a highlight from earlier. I think I've tried a slightly different editing style in this one than I usually do. And I think it came out pretty well, and so I'm really looking forward to people's feedback. So let's see if we can make it to 150, and I'll show you the video, and see if we can get a little preview of it. Nothing there. Moving on. Is that ship better than the Diamondback Explorer? Personally, I like to have the bigger fuel scoop. I do like the Explorer too. But I think the Phantom is a great ship. Nineteen jumps to go. Less than 20 now. I'm like the Star Citizen Kickstarter now. Yeah, the detached camera also works super cruise. I know. Oh, there we go. So you can do cool shots like this, for instance, if we do like that. Then we can do like a pan around the ship as it flies away. Whee! That always looked good. Or you can also do like, also like these where you put the ship in the corner and then do a slow rotation. Hey, Shadow. That also looks cool. Especially we have something interesting in front of us. Did I check this system? Or did I get too caught up in oh, wake scanner. I think I did. Yeah, one body. Okay, got it. Yeah, I know. I am very familiar with the camera, the free camera. We are, I think we should be around 1,000 light years straight up, straight north from Colonia. Currently heading down towards Colonia. I want to see if we can make it back in the live stream today, which we should be able to. Buddies, nothing there. But I guess the shot you were talking about is when you go out and you like lock it to the ship and then have the ship freely rotate in the frame like this, so you can basically let the ship move around in the frame. Is power play actually worth it? If you find it enjoyable, then yes. But if you're looking at it from like a money-making perspective, then no. And of course, you also get access to the power play modules. For that, that is worth it. I think it's okay. I think it's worth it to do power play for the modules. And of course, if you enjoyed, then yes. But if you're doing it for the money, you're probably better off doing other things. Planning on a new save and going with the Imperial Cutter. I have a bit of an idea. And that is to try and take a character from the bubble to Colonia without ever buying a ship. So not, I'm not even going to use the stock sidewinder. I'm basically going to hitchhike my way to, to Colonia. The problem is that I can't go on a fleet carrier because I'm not going to be allowed to use a ship. So I have to have people come someplace, pick me up so I can walk on board their ship and then have them fly me to Colonia. Now yeah, exactly, don't forget your towel. I don't know what it will do if I log out in their ship. Will it then send me back to the last station I was at? I don't know. Yeah, exactly. But last time when I did it, I logged out on a planet. I think I was in his ship and we were on a planet. When I came back in, he moved the ship and I just spawned on a planet. So I don't believe I can log out while they're flying. I believe I have to be there while they're flying. Oh, hold on. We got something here. Another war world. I think it could be a fun experiment. There's some pretty cool looking planets here. I like the last one there. Ooh, that's Mars. Early days Mars, maybe. It still has water on it, it looks like. That's probably a candidate for terraforming. Find someone who wants to speed to hitchhike to Colonia. Yeah, I'm hoping they will put me off on like a station somewhere. Commander Arthur Dent. I'm pretty sure Commander Arthur Dent would be taken already. I think I'm gonna do it on Howard O'Connor. There's the water world, at least. System scan complete. There we go. Let's see what we got. Look at that. Every single body in this system has an atmosphere. Every single one of them. What? So there's a terraformable. That one's terraformable. That one's terraformable. So we got 3 terraformables and a water world and a moon around the water world that's landable. I think we're gonna go down to that moon as well, just to take a look, see what's there. But let's scan the terraformables first. There could be some cool shots. If that moon is close enough to the water world, there could be potential for some really awesome shots. Only thing is, it might be a little too far away from the star, but we are going to get that dense star field as we do have out here. But we are going to be quite far away from the main star, so we're not going to get that much sunlight. Okay, it is bright though. It is a very bright star. So that's good. Oh, we are at 52 likes. Okay, you know what? Let me just scan this planet here, and then on our way to set a slow approach for the next one, and then I will set up the video so you guys can watch it. I think you like it. It's a highlight from last week's live stream, so there's nothing like new in it. But again, as I said, I tried a slightly different editing style, and the video will be, of course, be published later this week. So it's going to be a little preview there. Oh, that's a good question. Do I think more people play Odyssey or Horizon? Horizon. I still think Horizon. Because of two reasons. Mainly because Odyssey didn't get the best... didn't get the best launch that a video game has ever had. I think that's safe to say. And secondly, because we have all the console commanders who still don't even have the option to play Odyssey yet. Do we have here 6? Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, come on. 5 and 6. Feeling burned out of the lead and just don't know what to do. So, my recommendation is if you're feeling burned out of the lead and you're looking for a project, I will promise you there's something in the lead that you have never done, at least not to the point where you are like super comfortable with it. Maybe that's Stargoid hunting. Maybe that's looking into BGS. BGS is one of those where very few people play look into it. But it is a super complicated topic, and it's one of those topics where if you understand BGS and you know how it works, you can have a huge impact on the galaxy. You're more than welcome to come by Discord and join up with TerraX. We run, so TerraX is our in-game faction, and we have people posting basically daily orders where people can, oh, I should move towards, I haven't forgotten the video, I just wanna keep moving here. So there are daily orders you can follow if you're just interested in that. Alternatively, if you're more interested in what's going on behind the scenes, like why does the orders look like that, if you're interested in the BGS mechanics, we have some very knowledgeable people that knows a lot. What is BGS? BGS is the background simulation. So you know how systems, they change from being in boom, they can be in famine, they can be in war, they can be all kinds of things, and stations are changing hands, new people take over stations, all that stuff. That is the background simulation, or BGS. But those effects can be altered. They can be affected by players' actions. So when you have groups of players that go together and they try to all work to alter the BGS in a specific direction, often to favor the faction that they're working for. Super complicated. And it's also, the funny thing is, it's undocumented. And it's a niche within Elite, so they're also There are two things. There are fewer people who actually really have a in-depth knowledge of it, and the ones that does have a tendency to keep that knowledge close, because having that knowledge about how BGS works and the most effective ways to affect it, that means that you're just more effective at taking over space, taking over new stations, than other people, and that can be. And that can be important since space is really becoming a premium for player factions. Oh, look at that. They actually look like they're pretty close. Okay, before we scan these though, I'm just gonna see. Well, there should only be one planet here. Didn't I just spot two? Oh, look at that. So, oh, that's interesting. Look at that. That's planet four. There's the water world. That's planet five. And there's planet six. Now, oh, right, they do orbit each other. Never mind. There should be two planets here. Okay, before we do that, just give me a second and I'll find that video that I promised I would show you. Let me just give me a second here. I have to go in through the YouTube studio, so I'll gonna go full space camera here. Content and video. And let me just find it. There. Nope. Nope, not that one. There we go. Gotta hide myself. How many SRVs do I have with me? I have two SRVs. I have to drive down in that. Oh, this is actually a cool shot too. Little bit of the dark side. Time to go for a drive. We are very much sliding now. Look at me. And then just zoom way out so it actually looks like we are in a cave. I probably want that there. And we want to be able to see that, like this. See if we can get out of this hole. Oh, that is... There is no way. So when I'm driving up the wall, as soon as I'm forward, I can move myself away from the wall. Forward, I've used up so much. What I'm trying to do is come around the side, and then have that momentum as I can, and then begin to boost later. Okay, here we go again. Going into the war ride. And towards the edge. Oh, this one felt good. Yes! Oh my god! And there you have it. I had a little bit too much fun when I was editing that one. was this planet 4? Yes, this is planet 4. The day Astro defeated that volcano, yeah, exactly. And the whole thing started because someone on the last stream mentioned that I should just take that like hour I spent trying to drive up on the side of the volcano and then put it to Benny Hill. And I thought, I can't use Benny Hill, but then I have that other track that kind of sounds a little bit like it. Kind of a little bit similar. Come on. No, I didn't get it. Oh, it's also 7 probes. Okay, that's fine then. But then after I did the little speed up, it just felt weird to go back to just showcasing the whole thing flying up. And then I got a little creative and I tried to take that time. I spent like 2 or 3 minutes explaining how I wanted to go and wall riding and then boosting and turning and all that. I decided to take that and then mix it together so it looked like I just spent 2 hours explaining how I wanted to drive the SRV, and then put some epic music in front of the last attempt, and I think it came out great. I think it was pretty funny. Okay, we need to find... Thank you, Alex. Was it you who suggested it? I think it was. Triumphant escape, exactly. Very triumphant. But basically, I just went into YouTube's music library and I said, I want cinematic music with a, I think I said, inspirational mood. I was like, okay, what does it come up with? And then I found that one. Like, fine, that'll do. 6 probes here. I'm a little bit sluggish with my probe today. Not perfect, but it should be good enough. Yeah, there we go. Okay. Now comes the interesting one, which is first the water world, which should be pretty. So how's the Odyssey now? I think I remember Javix calling it unplayable. in the early stages. Has it changed? Odyssey has changed a lot since launch. A lot. First of all, stability has been improved significantly. Again, still have the occasional crash, but it's not worse than Horizon, I think, in terms of stability. It's still very like resource intensive in some situations, like conflict zones. It can still be resource intensive to run in those situations, but they are improving it. They are making steps to making it better. And it looks like update 7 we're getting should contain a very decent number of quality of life upgrades, which would be super nice. Yeah, I still think the biggest hurdle for Frontier right now is still to get Odyssey to a state where it can be played on console. At least last gen consoles, because that is, after all, I think large part of the player base is on those consoles, and I think they would expect to be able to play it. But it has improved a lot. I still think Odyssey is a little light on content. I mean, after you unlock your engineers and you've upgraded your first suits, now don't get me wrong, there's a lot of play hours in that, but it's also a lot of very repetitive play hours. But once you've done that, it is a little light on content after that. But hopefully there's gonna be more. They mentioned today in the Supercruise news, they talked about how some of the changes they're doing to conflict zones to make them more supportive of this whole sphere of combat that they sold the update with, that you're gonna have on foot and SRVs and ships all fighting in the same space. They're making steps towards making that more feasible. I'm really not sure if their approach, how it's going to work. Either it's going to work brilliantly and it's going to have exactly the effect, but it could also have the opposite effect of just completely driving all ships and SRVs away from on-foot combat. If they overdo it, basically. So what they're doing is, right now, ships and SRVs are overpowered in combat, in on-foot combat, because the ships can basically just sit in orbit and shoot people on the ground. And the SRVs are so tanky, not super tanky, but they do so much damage that you can just sit and kill people super fast. So they're trying to counter that by putting in more surface-to-air defense on the conflict zones. And they're also adding NPCs with rocket launchers. That's going to be the counter for SRVs. So the combat is going to be a lot more difficult. But if they balance it wrong, so let's say that you get one-shotted by a rocket NPC in the SRV, then the SRVs get useless. And similarly, if even a big, fully engineered Corvette cannot survive hanging over a conflict zone, then you're going to drive the ships away as well. Ship weapons against on foot, yeah, if you use missiles. Just use missiles with an area of effect damage. What do they use to shoot back? Normal guns. No, against the ships, there are surface-to-air like turrets on the base that shoots back towards the ships. So, but dumpfire missiles from a ship against on-foot people is very effective. Oh yeah, and there should also be NPC ships flying above the area. Now, that is something that could be really cool. If you actually have NPC ships from both factions fighting each other above the base, that would add so much to the combat, I think. If you're running around down on the ground shooting up people, while above you there are spaceships shooting each other as well, I think that would do a lot to add to that feeling of it being like a complete boat, ship, and on foot experience. So I hope they do that. No. You do not carry them around. These are stuff that are installed in the installations where the conflicts are. They are, yeah, combined arms. Thank you, Don. You don't carry anti-ship weapons on your back. They are like installations, like big turrets that are installed at the base. that then shoot at the ship. And yeah, exactly. High beyond all this also mentioned here, like ship combat in gravity would be fun. That means that suddenly having a good like power to weight ratio on your ship is super important. So I think if they balance it right, this can be really good. But if they get the balance off and they overdo it, then all they're doing is they're driving SRVs and they're driving ships away from the conflict zone. Which I think is the opposite of what they're trying to do. That is a very pretty moon. How close are we to the planet? Oh, that's actually close enough that we can actually see it. Surface scan complete. Hold on, what is on this planet again? There's nothing on this planet. What are the blue areas then? I'm gonna go and try to go for a day-night terminator again. But I need it in a place where I can also see the planet. Where is that? Yeah, it's all the way up there. So that means I need to go down in this area right ahead here. Similar type of atmosphere as we had before. Are they changing the bookmarks? So they're giving you more bookmark space so you can have more bookmarks, and they're also giving us more module storage so we can store more modules. No, no, the planet is not blue. It's an overlay to show where there are stuff on the surface. It's just a heat map. There you go, heat map is now gone. Oh, but the gravity is also a little bit. Now, did I judge my... Oh yeah, look at that. It's actually a little bit higher in the sky than I originally thought. Yeah, long live shields. I have some older BGS tutorial videos. I haven't done anything with Odyssey specific after the other thing were changed, but mainly because it takes time to actually figure out how it works because this is undocumented. I'm just gonna go a little bit in this direction. Hopefully we can get that planet a little bit closer to the horizon. What I'm thinking is I want to have that panning shot where we start by looking at the planet And then we pan across the horizon over to the star. I think that could be a cool shot as well. Okay, how do we do this time? Come on. That's a little better. So you can do like a pan, like... I would actually like it to be even lower in the... even lower down. Oh, hold on. Need to go to super cruise and not jump. That was a hyperspace jump. There we go. So that needs to be lower in the horizon. We'll kind of keep that little nebula, the Colonia Nebula, below it. And if we keep that above the horizon, that would be great. So we're more the Colonia Nebula just at the horizon. Maybe on the far side of that crater could be cool, so we can kind of have a... I think I'm gonna shoot for the far side of that crater, so we can kind of look at from the edge of the crater, and we're gonna kind of have the crater in front of us. We can see the shadow, we can see the sunlight. And hopefully also we got to see the water world. Check how this looks from here. Yeah, that's perfect. So now we can have that. Now there was a lot of blue here, but I don't believe there's actually anything on the planet. I don't know if that was a bug. Because it didn't show up as there if there were anything. Nope. But let's just scan the surface for good measures here, just to see if we can find anything. That crater there. Buck Rabbit, thanks a lot for the raid and welcome. Okay, let's see if we can get some cool shots. I don't believe there's gonna be any place where we can comfortably put this thing down. It seems a little bit too rough around here. But let's try to see if we can. Nope, it's too rocket. I'm not getting anything. Hey, Frost Shark, thanks a lot for becoming a channel member. Awesome. Nope, there's nothing here. That's okay. We'll just do it with the ship hovering. We are going to be in free camera anyway. Okay, so the shot I'm looking for is like a pan. Something like this, right? And I just want it to be a little slower. So I'm just going to go over to the other screen so I can start my recording. We should be recording there. And let's get it out of the way so I can actually see chat while I'm doing this. So basically we're going to start and just do a slow... I need to not rotate the camera. Try to keep the horizon level through the whole shot. It's a little bit too slow. Get a bit more speed there. Work with that horizon. Nice. I'm just going to play around a bit. Kind of like it, this area here. The stars look a little, what if we do super wide maybe? Then we just need it to be ultra slow. I think I like this one a little bit better. Gonna try it at just different zoom levels here. Then I can always decide in post which one I like the most. Just all the colors. I like these, the transition between the green and the blue and the yellow and the orange colors in between. And then just absolute field of stars that we have. Great. Stop that recording. Where is this? Where is the scientific proof of planets having gravity in space? with the exception of our blue marble, like every probe we use to gravity slingshot around them. I mean, Voyager was slingshotted around, I think, maybe not all of them, but most of the planets in the solar system. Oh, you could also argue. Hold on, did wrong again. The Mars Viking lander is a pretty good proof that there is gravity. So the Mars Viking lander, no, sorry, sorry, not Viking lander. Polar lander. Sorry, my bad. The Polar lander, little probe that was supposed to land on the south pole of Mars, but because of an incorrect conversion between inches and meters. The rockets that were supposed to slow down the craft fired way too late, meaning the whole thing just crashed into the southern pole of Mars and broke up into a million pieces. That too nails the fact that we can see that the moons are orbiting around Jupiter. I don't even know where to start. I mean, you can take a very, very cheap telescope, and you can look at the moons of Jupiter, at least the four Galileic moons. You can see the four Galileic moons even with a cheap telescope, and you can observe them night after night after night, and you can see them orbit around the planet. So go and look at it yourself. Now, what I actually wanted to do, well, we're probably too far away from the planet now. I wanted to see here on our way up if there were any cool spots, but that's pretty much gone, isn't it? Steve says, hearing rumors that there's something happening on Tuesday in Colonia. See, I have heard the same, and that's why we're heading to Colonia now. I am 15 jumps away. I'm jumping for 5 minutes. Is this normal? No. Congratulations, you got yourself a Braven tunnel. Close the game and open it up again. I would really like some other colors, atmospheres, and I would also like to see some planets with some actual plants on them. Recovered, great. Now, I don't think I'm gonna speedrun Colonia from the bubble. I would have to have other people. I would gonna hitchhike my way to Colonia. Yeah, right. I'm moderately powered by binoculars. Can probably see the Galileic moons too. You really don't need anything big fancy to see the Galileic moons of Jupiter, and you can see them orbit night after night as they move around the planet. You might even be able—I can't even remember the orbit times—but you might actually be able to see them move during the night. I can't remember the exact orbit times. A bit of time, just we can make a Colonia flight. There shouldn't be any problems. Oh no, it could be fun. I'm sitting here thinking. I'm still constantly thinking about that, like hitchhiking, and then if people want to, at least if I can find people who want to take me along for the ride, and if they would then be interested in doing like a small interview, so like interview people as they fly me around the galaxy. That could be fun. Exactly. Our Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy would probably be a very good name for a series like that, or yeah. Do I own a Star Tracker? I have actually one showing up in, because I used to use that telescope until the internals gave up. But I actually have something coming in the not too distant future. I might do a review of it. I know it's not something that may be super interesting to everybody, but I think astrophotography gear is interesting, and it could be fun to try. It's like it's basically a motorized head for like a camera head that you put on top of a tripod, but it's motorized and it has a built-in star tracker. So instead of having like a big like equatorial mount, you just have a camera head like about that size that you put on top of a tripod, and then you have an app, and then it says go there, and it goes, and then you have your camera on it, and that, at least that's what it says it does. Now we'll see how well it works. Chat vote one if you're interested in astrophotography gear. Oh, look at that. Now we have that purple glow. I think this is not a Titauri star. Nope, that's a brown dwarf. This one should definitely be purple. Okay, that's definitely some interest. I'll do a review of it when we get some astrophotography gear. We could probably find a wolf rayet. Shouldn't be too difficult. Ah, finding it randomly. Yeah, okay. Nothing there. Can't be many, less than 10 jumps now. We must be close. That nebula is getting awfully big. Down to earth astrophotography. Yeah, the channel was actually supposed, when I first created, to be an astronomy channel talking about space and whatnot, but yeah, slowly turned into to one more space games instead of just talking space. Look at that. Eight jumps and we're back in Colonia. It's gonna be interesting to see how much money we made in terms of profit. I don't think it's a lot, but should be a little bit. That should be, I don't know, I'm guessing like 40, 50 million maybe. Maybe I'm overshooting a bit. Cabot. Right now we're just making our way towards Colonia, and if we find anything interesting along the way, we stop, we shoot video, and it looks and look at pretty things. Basically just looking for pretty sights. But I really want to find some plants at some point. We can do, and hopefully plants on like an interesting atmospheric world would be fun. Lord Winter, guess I'm gonna make 1 billion. I think that's highly unlikely. Given that I've only been out for 2 weeks, I think. Yeah, I started the trip 2 weeks ago. Fuel scoop disengaged. Frameshift drive charging. 6 jumps. Threw away 40 mil of data canyon running like a fool last week. Oh, that's sad. Two weeks, then you'll say 5 to 10 million. I will see. I think it's more than 5 to 10. Feel like it should be more than 5 to 10. How far from the bubble? I am 5 jumps from Colonia right now. So what is that? 20,000-ish? 21? I can't remember exactly. I think like 21,000. Yeah, I know Astro Backyard. I have watched some of his videos. He does very good. Like, what I like about him is he does videos for all, like, all entry, all levels, right? Both of the super expensive massive telescope, but also for, like, entry level photography. He's a really good guy. He does some good videos. Really good videos. Ah, billions. That is, I would promise you, it's if I make 5 to 10 billions, then I found something out here that was very, very valuable, apparently. No, nothing there. Fuel scoop disengaged. Frameshift drive charging. Reward for fighting Raxler slash Stanton. Now, so if we are talking astronomy gear, like the ultimate dream in terms of astronomy gear for me would be to like to buy a piece of land out in the middle of nowhere and just build a house on it, so you have a place to stay, but then also have an observatory somewhere that you would. Like on the piece of land, right? And then you would have it all automated, and you could access, like, basically hook it up to like a Raspberry or something. So you could SSH into a remote desktop into the PC from home. And then I could sit here in the middle of the city. Yeah, I know I'm nerding again. Could sit here in the middle of the city, and then have access to a telescope out somewhere where there's not so much light pollution. See, now that would be awesome. Thought you were a physicist and not an astronomer. So the way, at least in Denmark, the way it works here is you study physics and then you specialize in astrophysics as your specialization. Astros Observatory, exactly. Put the telescope on a drone. I don't think drones are stable enough for that. But then comes all the problems, because if you build a remote observatory, you need to motorize everything. You need to motorize the movement of the dome. You need to motorize the movement of the slit to open it up. And you need to make sure the dome can track along with the telescope. So if you do long exposures, then as the telescope turns, you need, of course, make sure that the dome follows with it. So that slit in the dome, unless you're going to have like a fully open one where the whole thing opens up. But also making sure that all that motorized gear, computer hardware, all that stuff is actually going to survive a Danish winter. That is... Yeah. There's a telescope flying on a... Okay, but there's a difference between a drone and a 747. 747s are slightly bigger than most drones. But that's like the ultimate dream someday. Try and build a remote... remotely controlled observatory. Cabot says, if I'm going to spend hardcore money, might as well put it up outside Denmark. Yeah, true, but I also want it to be someplace I can get in a reasonable amount of time. Yeah, exactly. Probably just have a simple roll-up roof so that the whole roof goes away. Then it alleviates the problem of having to have the dome track the telescope. Maybe someday. Buy 1 to 2 acres on the North Pole. Problem is you can't, because nobody owns it. No, you can't buy land on the North Pole. Where do you go to avoid light pollution? Far away from big cities. Yeah, I'll show you something. Now I'm getting sidetracked, but you guys know I get sidetracked very, very easily. Here we go. So if you go to lightpollutionmap.info, you get... Not my camera, that's for sure. There we go. You get a map like this. And here, you can see the degrees of light pollution. So you can see, for instance, here in... around the area of... Not even around Amsterdam, most of the Netherlands here are just like... Very light blue. You can see London here. So, if you look at Denmark, there's Copenhagen. You can see Malmö, Hamburg. So a good area close by is like over in this area. If you could go down south in this direction, there's also, it's only like the light green, which is not too bad. Like ideally you want to go over here, but that's a bit too far to drive. Wait, what? You're getting interdicted? Seriously? One thing I didn't expect today was to get interdicted. I'm too close to Colonia. Oh, this thing does not turn very well. We're gonna crash into a star now. Oh, wait, what? Oh, we are in Colonia. Okay, well, that explains. Let's get this thing on the path then. Shut. But though, light pollution map is good, so you can go, you can see where there is the least light pollution in your area. So you know where to go if you want to have dark skies. Question, I'm just wondering this pass. If I play Elite, does that limit me to ships? What? Hello? Gotta get back. Gotta get the data sold. And then we should be ready for if something happens. Today on stream, Astro gets distracted by astronomy talk and accidentally ends up in Colonia. Have you looked at any pretty systems in there are some pretty planets here. But what I would really like is an atmospheric planet with rings on it. I think that would look really, really good. And if there are some plants as well, that would be even better. Gotta overshoot it then by. Oh! No! I think I got it. Ah! A little late. Almost got it. Have I ever played No Man's Sky? Yes, it's a year, about a year and a half ago maybe now, but I have. We have, I'm okay, says, just want to stop by and thank you for the amount of work that you put into this community and how much you have helped so many. You are very welcome. I do this because I enjoy it. Because I'm having fun. Always love Colonia and Jack Station in particular because there are so many landing pads. When are you guys on the Colonia trip when we flew the North Star out here? Right after the North Star arrived and we dumped up like 1,000 commanders in Colonia at once. Every single landing pad in Jack Station was lit up at the same time. It was beautiful to see. It was such a fun trip. I need to do more carrier trips. Okay, time to sell some data. How much money do I have on this character? 253 million credits. Let's sell ourselves some card talk data. If it's gonna load anything. Come on! I do not have that much data. There we go. Thank you. Yeah, you can't do colonial. Oh, look at that. That page alone was 32 million. And we have another page. Orange Sidewinder. No, no. Just very, very slow service. So my prediction of 40 to 50 might actually not be too far off. I have found stuff. And 11 on that one. Putting us up at 44. Maybe a little bit extra. That's 11 and a half. So let's head into the bar and sell some of the plant data we found. What would be the best ship for a trip to Beagle Point? Anything you don't mind spending a lot of time in, I would say. We still haven't sold all of it. We still have a little bit of data. Actually, FPS is okay. 60.
Catch you later. Welcome to Vista Genomics. I trust you have bio data you wish to sell.
Yes, I do.
Let's see what you've got for us.
Okay, I got two planets, one for 100, and that's not a lot of data, is it? 300,000. So about page total is 690.
Anything more to share? Thank you for your contribution to our research.
Should be 120. Yeah, should, but it's better than it was, that's for sure. I used to be able to run at like 40 in stations like this. So, definitely better than it was. Okay, we're here. Now what? Now I guess we wait for 2 days. Stock up with just med packs. That's a good idea.
So what are you after today? None of these guns will let you down. Sure you've got everything?
Just gonna buy all of them.
I can't tell you how many times a medkit saved my life. never know when you'll need to top up your suit's power levels. Sure you've got everything?
I don't think this, I mean, this is Jack Station. There's nothing special here. If it was, it would have been gone already.
Come back anytime.
People asking what kind of ships you can buy here.
Wonderful. I'm here if you have any questions.
Sidewinder Eagle, Adder, Viper, Cobra Mark III, Diamondback Scout, Dolphin. Love the Dolphin. Scout, Asp Exploder, Crate Phantom, Crate Mark II, Orca, Fertilance, Mamba, Python, Beluga Liner. And all of these are not for sale. Hey, thanks for the raid. And welcome. I have four ships here. Apparently I also have a crate here. Right, so this is a mining. You can see it has mining lasers, abrasion blasters, seismic charges. This is both a coal miner and a laser miner. Railgun, railgun, frag cannon, frag cannon, frag cannon. What is this? It's a combat build, all right. Yeah, that's true. They, you know what? I might actually stick around in Colonia for a bit because they are going to bring in the 7 engineers and I don't want to head out for another trip. Not the 7 engineers. That update 7 should bring engineers to Colonia. So I don't think we necessarily want to leave Colonia just yet. What I am considering is to stick around in the area and then spend the extra time out here to upgrade my suits, because obviously these are completely stuck as I have done nothing on this character. You see, I only have the Artemis suit, basically. That's the only thing with a few laser weapons. Yeah, update 7 should bring engineers to Colonia. I think Frontier has confirmed it. You know what, we could actually do some B-roll shooting in the station here as well. Should we do that? That would be fun, wouldn't it? Let's shoot a little bit of B-roll here in the station. And start the recording. So I'm just going to hide my character in here. So we're not going to show up on the video. Especially now that we can actually just hide it behind a wall and he's not going to mess up the camera. So what would be good here for B-roll? I mean, the obvious one is like not doing a little bit faster now. Doing like, you know what, just gonna give me a second here. I'm just gonna, come here, there we go. I'm just gonna stop that recording. And then delete that latest recording. There. I just want to plan the shots beforehand, so we don't spend a lot of time on me just planning shots. So when an easy shot would be to have the camera like track down the length of the station here, pass some NPCs that are walking up there. And can we go through here? It's gonna be a very long shot though. Oh, I have a cool idea for a shot. So I'm just gonna wait for an NPC to walk down the stairs again. You can't take a taxi that far. Come on. Right, we can just do it with maybe without. There's going to be plenty of NPCs walking around, I guess. So, place the camera there. Go over here and start the recording. We are recording. And then shoot it from here. A little bit slower this time. Keep on going. And we need to get the window completely engulfed here. There we go. Perfect. I'm gonna stop it there. And then what I wanna do, here comes the funny part. We're gonna go down to the ship, we're gonna put the ship on the pad, and then we're gonna continue the same shot on the other side of the window, and then in post, I'm gonna stitch those two shots together. So hopefully, I don't know if it's gonna work, but hopefully I'm trying to get that transition of the camera moving through the glass and out into the hangar. So it should be right here. Oh, we can't get the camera down far enough. See, there I hit a wall, so I can't go there. Hold on. Nah. There we go. My problem is I do not have forward. I do not have forward control over the camera now. Oh, but Frontier also fixed this. The bug camera won't even go in there anymore. That's a shame. That's the closest thing it's allowing us to do, but maybe it's going to be good enough. Now, pad 27 is not lit up anymore. But it's not going to work because we need that thing there in frame. So, well, worth a try, but you can't do it because the... it's not going to let us go closer to it than that. Then it sent us up above. Oh well, we got one good shot out of it. That is unfortunate. No, we shouldn't zoom because that's going to be very hard to hide. We need to have the same focal length between the two shots. Otherwise, it's going to be very difficult to hide in post. I mean, we could get pretty close to those windows there. So, what if we tried something like this here? Okay, so right now we're still doing practice shots here. So, kind of the same thing, you know. Run down the length of it here. And then when we come around and do not hit the sofa, we go up. Is there a center-mounted window anywhere? We need to go up to those windows there. So, like, run down here, and then we flip it up for that window there. Can we get that in frame? Not on its own. So that means we need to zoom in a little bit. There, now we can get it in frame. That means our shot's gonna look a little bit more like this, where we run down with a zoomed in lens. And that transition I can make. Now I just need to test one thing. That is, how many clicks did I zoom in for that? I need 3 clicks. Yes, I don't read the Twitch chat right now. Sorry, I'm just a little bit preoccupied with planning my shots here. Okay, let's try to make it. I don't want my character in shot. Yeah, UI show zoom. All right, yeah, of course. 2.8. Just gonna start the recording. If I can find my mouse. There it is. Nice and slow. In for the turn. Damn it, there was an asp just as I did the end of the shot. We cannot... I need to have it clean from ships. Otherwise, we're not going to get it seamless enough. We have some NPCs walking. That's good. That's a little bit more movement in the scene here. A little bit more life than just NPCs sitting. Going up and going for the turn. Oh, turn too far. Damn it. Try it again. Tracking down the center. clean off the bridge, turn a little bit, and rotate. There's the window. Looks clean. There we go. I might be able to hide the cars. Okay. Just go and stop that recording. Ah, come on. Where's my mouse? There it is. Okay. So we were at... From the front...
The galaxy can be a dangerous place.
Fourth window from the front, right? Yeah, fourth window from the front. Let's go out. Yeah, the edge of the... I know I got the edge of the window, but that's... Oh, I got my head tracking on, that's why. That's okay that I got the that I got that on. That that I can hide, I think. Seven over on Twitch. Okay, so UI 2.8 there. Fourth window from the front, so that is that window there. We started that. Probably start recording. Ah. Okay. Fourth window there. Get the framing right. Wrong window. No, no. 1, 2, 3, fourth window. That's fine. Okay.
I'm late, is it?
Ah, it's okay. I think maybe we can use that. Just for fun, I'm just going to transfer the video over. And then we can just play around with it just a little bit, just to see what we can do with it. And we can actually make that transition seamless enough that we can kind of hide it. This is going to be a very big if... But first thing I need to do is just to make sure I get this thing transferred. This is going to be live streaming, pre-stream, elite. And then I'm going to make a new folder called Elite Odyssey. And transfer files in there. just 6 gigabytes. That's not too bad. Yeah, it's like an ASP thing, isn't it? If an ASP sees someone with a camera, they must go and stand in front of the camera. Okay, but while the data is transferring... we can go ahead and just do a little bit of prep work here. It doesn't matter if it was the exact window. It just, in order to get it as close as possible. Hold on, I need to get my folder over here. Elements, pre-stream. Yeah, there it is. Get you guys back. Elite Odyssey. This one's being populated right now. So we're just gonna get a 1080p video file. We're just gonna call this one test. There we go. Oh, and transfer is done. So we now have all the video files we've been recording. Let's get Vegas up and running. Star Citizen video I've been working on. Well, it's actually done. It just needs to be rendered, but I haven't had time to set that up yet. Restream. Elite. Boom. Here we have the base one. We can get rid of all of this stuff here. We don't need that. Actually, let me just move my camera down in the other corner. Delete those tracks. We don't need the introduction tracks. So get rid of those. We don't need that one. That one, okay, don't need anything of this outro subscriber clicking thing. But what I do need is that. And that. Okay. First, the transition. I'm just going to scrub through it. So you see, where's the last frame where I'm moving? Right? That's the one I'm looking for here. Last frame with movement in it. It's about that one. So we're going to split it there. Get rid of the remainder. Follow the track backwards until we started. About there. Okay. So now we have the initial track. No, I'm not on call. I quit my old job and got a new one. So I'm never on call again. Not that the on call part was that bad. And there we have it, right at the end of the shot, right as it hits the window. So now we can take the other half here. And we have all of this. Wait, no, stop that. And then movement starts. There, okay. So now we just need to try and kind of line these two up so they kind of look the same. And this is where it's good that we are more money, that too, but also more interesting tasks. This is where it's good that we're recording in 4K because it gives us a little bit of leeway to crop in and work with this. So what I think I will do is I want to give it like a half second overlap between the two. And then here, Okay. I'm just looking at where the different reference points here. So what I'm going to do is... I'm actually going to do something different here. I'm going to create a new video track and a new audio track, and I'm going to put the other clip up on that track there, and then make the fade like so instead, so that we still have the fade and I can still, you know, swap between them. And then what I'm going to do is, I'm going to open up this one. And then we're going to set it there. I'm going to desync it from the main cursor, like so. And then we're going to begin to try to line these two clips up. So this one, for instance, needs to go in. Like there. Kind of see we need. It's going to be a hard one to hide this one, I think, because we didn't actually get the framing that good. Maybe let's start by, okay, hold on, let's do something different here. Let's start by just get the framing right here. So what do we need to be able to see? We need to have just the edge of that. I actually need to have to go all the way out there then. I have not a lot of experience in these kind of transitions, so this is very new to me. How far down are we going to be able to see? We can see down, actually almost down to that. Okay, what we need to do is we need to give ourselves a little bit more to work with here. So we're going to try to make a... a slight zoom here on this part of it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go in and I'm going to add a point there, add a point at the end. And at the end, we're going to zoom us in a little bit. Now, this means that the end here is going to zoom in, and we're going to end up with a narrower view of the output at the end. So now I can try to say, is it M for muting? No, that's not M. That was marker. Come on. Delete. There we go. Right. Put it there. And now we can begin to do the cropping on this one with a desync cursor. So then flip between them. So we need to be able to go down, whoops, down there. But we can also still see How's that? It's getting there. How does that look now? What if we make the transition faster? Are you kidding me? That wasn't even... No, okay, there we go. It just froze there for a second. It's not the most... It's not really that convincing, is it? Like, at all? I mean, it's not even close to being in the right position. Maybe I should try it in a different way to see if I have more luck with that. Yeah, the angle was not spot on as spot on as I hope. What if we try something else here? What if we do it like this? We do it with a track instead. I think maybe this is not gonna work. Yeah, the angle was all wrong. What's going on here? Oh, it's locked to one of the axes. There we go. Yeah, I think a reshoot would be required, but that's not going to be now. Because this is definitely not gonna... This ain't gonna work. But I might just instead of trying to do that transition, because there's also the problem that the windows, the colors here, like the colors in that shot and that shot is also very different. And making that transition is gonna be super hard. We can maybe try to trim it, as people are suggesting. So I can't go higher than that. If I want that to be higher, I need to zoom in more. Oh, is that not even close, I guess? Yeah. I was just further off than I thought it would be. Because this is going to be very noticeable as well. Needs to be a much, much longer fade as well. Can we maybe hide it with the... I'm just gonna try something. It may not work. I'm just gonna try to do like a little speed ramp here. So basically, as we do the turn here, I'm gonna speed us up. To like, I don't know, 300%. Let's try that to start with. Needs to be faster. Let's pull this up to, I don't know, 1,000. And then pull that back. Well, that's just, the ramp was actually okay before. Because now that clip is ending there. No, it's ending earlier. Need to get the right frame here. There. Because now, when this is faster, we might be able to sneak this one in. By also adding some speed to this one. Now, I know the color's gonna be off, but we can always fix the colors afterwards. Insert velocity envelope. And then we just need to try and make these two velocities kind of match. And then just keep that speed up. Kind of until like there-ish. Add point, and then pull that down to normal speed. And then pull that forward a bit. There. Normal speed. Okay, so how does that look? So now I just need to try and make this one kind of have the same colors as the other one. Then it might be a little, I mean, it's not going to be perfect. So this one looks very blue, right? So we're going to add some to the highs. We're going to add some blue. It's a bit more like a tone like that. And then like so, sync that up to the cursor. Then there, you're gonna try to pull that back to zero like so. How does that look? It needs to be later that we get rid of that blue tint effect. Gotta make this window a little bit smaller. I think maybe the fade is not, I don't know, need to be longer maybe. And now it's not lined up anymore. All right, I don't think that's gonna line up very well, but there were some cool shots in there. They may be work like be doable to work with, like on their own. I mean, the shot of this one going out the hangar alone was actually pretty cool. I know this is cropped in all kinds of weird ways right now. Let's send it back to default. Like, that shot alone there was actually pretty cool, I think. Yeah, the window tint is expected to go away, so I wanted to have the window tint be at the beginning of the second clip and then disappear. But this shot alone was also pretty cool. I'm not sure if I'm going to use this clip here. It was mainly just because I wanted to try that window effect, but it's a little bit more difficult getting the same framing as I thought it would be. Anyway, worth a try. Anyway, that's mean I'm gonna call it for today. I would have to go back and reshoot some of that if we wanted to actually make that transition work. Yeah, I don't know. It's past midnight. I need to go in and go into sleep. So I probably will have to skip the after part of the day. But anyway, sorry, I lost track here. That's gonna be it for today. Next scheduled live stream, I don't know. I think I'm gonna be able to get a live stream sometime over the weekend to play some Star Citizen. Exactly what I'm gonna do, I'm not sure. But Friday, I think there's a good chance I could get some live stream going there. So if you want to see some Star Citizen live streams, then I'm not sure it's gonna be Friday. I hope I can get something going there. But for now, I want to say a huge thank you to all you guys for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. And if you haven't liked this live stream already, please do that. Subscribe if you haven't done already. I would really appreciate that. Also, there's a whole host of links in the chat. The links for the merch store, of course, you found that at d2hstore.com. And there is still a discount code called SpaceCovid or Metalhead that you can use and get 10% off any merchandise in there. Go and check it out. There's some cool stuff. I'm pretty sure you'll find something you like. And of course, there's also a link for that channel's Discord server, discord.d2a.com, if you are interested in joining the channel's community. And if you just want someone to talk to or somebody to fly with, then that is a wonderful place. And you're right, Kelvin, I need to remember to raid, because I am really bad at remembering to raid. So I'm just going to quickly jump over here on Twitch and see who is streaming Elite Dangerous. Who is streaming Elite Dangerous on this fine evening? I am. Want some... Preferably some English-speaking channel. Would be nice. A20 Colonia continues. There's a guy who also does some Colonia stuff. Wooly. Not familiar with him, but let's find him. BGS. Let's give Wooly's a... English only has 7 viewers. That's where I'm going to send you guys. He's doing some BGS stuff, so that should be interesting. I think some on foot combat. I'm just going to make sure I get the raid command right this time. There we go. So that's been it for today. Thanks so much for watching. And until next time, I will see you guys in space.